talk and rock radio, where friends meet at the intersection of life, inspiration, and music. Here's your host, Rick Kern.
Welcome, everyone, to Talkin' Rock Radio. My guest today is a member of a group that set the standard for being one of the finest and most innovative vocal groups in the world. They have 11 Grammys to their credit, have sold millions of records, and in 2022 released their last album celebrating their 50-year anniversary. Welcome, Alan Paul of the Manhattan Transfer. How you doing, buddy?
Hey, Rick. Doing fine. Thank you.
Well, I'm glad you're okay out there in the rainy left side of the country, man. It's been quite a storm.
Yeah, this thing hit for a couple of days. I mean, it was crazy. You know, they're still trying to figure out what to do with all the residue. You know, the waters are still running down the hills and everything else. So, yeah, but fortunately, where I am, it's been all right.
That's not good.
Yeah.
Good to hear that, man. Well, Alan, I like to start these shows off, you know, and just talk about the beginning. You know, talk a little bit about your journey into the music industry. How did it all start for you?
Well, you know, I grew up in Newark, New Jersey, which is really kind of the New York metropolitan area. And I started in show business when I was a kid. You know, when I was 9 years old is when I kind of started. Actually started in vaudeville.
Well, and you were on Broadway. You were on Broadway also, right?
I was. This was before I was on Broadway. Yeah, I just started, you know, singing around and I say I was in vaudeville because I when I was a kid, I studied with this gentleman who was, I think at the time he was about 75 years old, and he had a school in Manhattan for kids, you know, and he would do these shows, and we would go and do all this music. I didn't realize it at the time, but we do all this music that was from the vaudeville period. It was like the beginnings of American popular music, you know, so it was a great way to start in a way to learn all about that music. But, you know, when I was 12, I was in the original Broadway cast of Oliver. And that kind of got me, in terms of that. And then I was a child actor in New York. And that's kind of how it all started.
And as far as getting into, I mean, you know, obviously your main instrument, your voice. But, I mean, what other instruments do you play?
I play keyboards. I play piano. I use it mostly for my writing songs and arranging, you know, not so much playing it. My singing is much better than my playing.
But, you know, as a songwriter, you know, I figured you probably for sure played keyboard because you do write. And you almost have to have a keyboard knowledge or a guitar knowledge to be able to write songs. So going back to 1972, when the Manhattan Transfer were really making some waves and everything, and, you know, talk a little bit about the members of the group, the transitions, how you got started with that group. Kind of take it from that point.
Well, I'll backtrack a little bit because I went to, after I studied at university, I got my degree in my BA in music education. And for that period of time, you know, I was doing occasional nightclub work and thing, you know, in the summer, you know, to make some money. But as soon as I graduated, I got back into the business. And I was in the 1971-72. I was in the original off-Broadway and then Broadway a cast of Grease. And so it was while I was in Grease that I serendipitously met my partners. because my partner Laurel Masse was dating the drummer in Greece.
Oh, okay.
So that's how I met Laurel, because she used to come backstage and hang out, you know, and I found out that she was a singer. And the guys that were the musicians that played in the Grease band, they put together a band because they were looking to get a record deal, and they were playing in a club. So I went down. It was a Sunday night, and I went down to see the guys, and Laurel and two other girls were singing background. The other girl was Janis Siegel.
Okay.
So they absolutely blew me away. I thought that they were incredible, you know. Laurel had this amazing, pitch-perfect, sultry soprano voice, mm-hmm. you know. And Janis, being a 19-year-old girl from Brooklyn, at one point she did a solo. She did Aretha Franklin's Dr. Feelgood.
Okay.
And I could not believe the voice coming out of this girl. It was like way beyond her years, you know, her understanding, the rawness and the power of her voice, and her understanding of rhythm and blues. And, so that was great. I wanted to hang out afterwards to meet Janis, but I had to get back. I had something going on. So then, a couple of weeks after that, I see Laurel backstage. She comes up to me and she says, you know, that girl Janis and I were putting together a group with this other guy, and we're looking for a fourth singer. And I asked around, and a couple of people said, well, you know, maybe Alan might be interested, because they knew that I had studied music, you know, I could write music and read music. And I also did a lot of nightclub work. So the last thing that I ever thought of doing was being in a group.
Okay.
Never even entered my mind, because I had always been on my own, always had my own career. It was going really well. But I wanted to meet Janis. I thought, well, I mean, maybe I'll ask her out on a date, you know. So I went down to meet with everybody at this guy, Timmy Hauser, at his apartment. And went there and walked in. And I was like in complete shock, because his living room, there was no furniture. It was just wall-to-wall boxes and crates of records. LPs, 78s, 45s. I mean, it was like amazing. And and Tim, I met Tim, and he kind of, you know, he walked out from the other room, here is this long-haired, this hippie with long hair and a beard. And I'm looking at this guy, and I'm thinking, I don't get it. I don't understand. So is it kind of like mamas and the papas? Is this what they want to do? I don't know. So anyway, we sat and we talked about this concept, this idea that he had to do a mixed vocal group doing closed four-part harmony, kind of like the voicings of the Count Basie sax section, or like the big band groups, like mm-hmm. the Pied Pipers, the Modern Airs, the Mary Max, groups like that.
Yeah.
But applying it to popular music and recording, you know, getting a record deal and recording. And it was intriguing to me, because we also talked about the changes that were going on, you know, in the music industry and in the world, really. You know, Vietnam was now over. So a lot of the clubs, like in New York, that were folk clubs, you know, were turning into cabarets, you know, because, you know, there was nothing to protest about anymore. So it was kind of like the beginnings of glitter rock, you know, that was going on. And there was, you know, the early beginnings of disco. There was a lot of stuff going on, a lot of transitions. And somehow we were going to fit into all that. And that was kind of the beginnings. That's where, you know, I said, well, this is intriguing to me, this idea. I said, I always loved groups, you know. And I said, well, maybe so. I had been in Greece already for about, you know, about 2 years. And I was bored, you know, doing the same thing, you know, 8 shows a week, the same thing all the time. And I was really looking to get back into my music, you know. So I said, okay, let's give this a shot.
And 50 years later.
never would have thought that. No. I mean, we, you know, being in the moment at the time, you never even, you know, never thought that far ahead. It's actually quite remarkable and amazing. And, you know, I'm so grateful for what we've been able to do, you know. But it took us a while, you know.
As I alluded to in our pre-show call, Alan, you know, I told you I've interviewed a lot of people with mini gold records and platinum records and stuff on the back wall, you know, or on their shelves or whatever. But you are the first that I have interviewed that I know of. I can't recall ever seeing any Grammys, but just kind of shift your head a little bit and let me let everybody see all those Grammys on the back shelf.
There are my babies right there.
Oh, yeah. Man. That is so cool. That is so cool. So you had 11 of them all together, right?
Yeah.
The I got to ask you this. I mean, they're all super special, I'm sure. But is there any one or more that you would say were bigger or better, you know? Or
well, I would say absolutely the very first one that we got for Birdland.
Yeah.
Because that was such an acknowledgement of everything that we were working for, everything that we were striving for, you know, prior to that. You know, we had been together since 72, and that happened in 80.
And the Grammy Award is given to?
You got it.
Manhattan Transfer, Birdland.
We'd like to thank Joe Zawinul for the music, writing the music. John Hendricks for the wonderful lyrics that practically sang themselves.
To Amin Erdogan and Sheldon Vogel of Atlantic Records for the great support. We'd like to thank our producer, Jay Graydon.
And most importantly, we cannot forget our manager, Brian Avnet. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
You know, so it was all those years, you know, and, you know, there's still more backstory because, you know, Laurel Masse left the group in 1979 and Cheryl Bentyne came in. Mm-hmm. And then it was with her when we got together with Jay Graydon, amazing, you know, guitarist. You know, he was like, you know, in LA, he was like the A guy to go to, you know, for studio work and stuff like that. But he was getting into producing, you know, he and David Foster, you know, they wrote After the Love Is Gone, you know, stuff like that. But so he produced that album that Birdland was on, you know, and Twilight Zone was on that. So it was a big departure from where we were before. But there's a lot of story before that, you know, just in terms of getting a record deal. You know, it took us 2.5 years to get a record deal.
Well, and speaking of that, not just Grammys here, but you all were also inducted into the Vocal Group Hall of Fame. What year did that take place?
Oh, hold on a second. That's it here.
Okay.
It says 1998.
Okay.
Inducted.
Outstanding. And where was that ceremony at?
That was in Sharon, Pennsylvania.
Okay. Nice. Yeah. Nice. Share with me, and you've already shared some really good stories, but share with me some of the most prized memories of being a TMT member, Alan. If there's any standout moments or anything that you would like to share along that line.
Well, I mean, there's so much to share. There's so much history, you know. I think the peak moments for us, you know, getting signed to Atlantic Records, you know, after 2.5 years, Ahmet Erdogan, who was the head of Atlantic Records, you know, it was finally, I'm sorry, I got these notices that are coming up.
That's okay.
You know, after having all the record companies come down and see us, representatives, you know, to finally get signed to Atlantic, which was really, you know, I think one of our first choices, you know, because of
Let's talk about that, because that was what I was going to launch into next. This is about the same time I'm out in LA with my bands going, you know, going on. We started out there in 73. But there's a good friend of mine, and you know him. He and Richard Perry had Studio 55, where you all did, I think, three of your albums. And yeah. One of those that, in fact, Howard and I were talking about that the other day. Howard Steele's who I'm talking about. He and I were talking the other day. He's from El Paso. He's up in Montana now. But we were talking about the Coming Out album. And that particular album, I always liked that album. I think that's the one that had, I think you had Posenciano on that one also, if I'm not mistaken.
That's right.
That's one of my favorite songs that you guys did. But back to Studio 55, Howard shared with me that you all, the Manhattan Transfer, was the very first project that he and Richard Perry took on there at Studio 5 when they first opened.
That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And what's really cool is on two of the cuts on that Coming Out album was Ringo Starr and Jim Keltner, you know, so.
Playing together.
Playing together. I mean, that is.
It was on Cindy Lou.
Yeah.
That came in. Yeah.
Yeah. So cool, man. So cool. Such great history. In fact, I got a call one time from Howard when we were out there playing, And he said, do you and Sharon want to come to the studio? We have Jeff Porcaro, who you also have recorded with. Jeff Porcaro was in there.
Yeah.
Jeff was in there recording a song for Diana Ross. So we got to go in and sit in the control room with Richard and Howard and watch that session and just watch the magic work. Those guys absolutely blew me away watching what they do. You know, it's just totally amazing. Talking about these albums, one of the albums that you did that was really unique, it was quite a departure from other things that you were doing at the time, and that's the one called Vocalese. Talk a little bit about that. You know, of course, you had Bobby McFerrin involved in that. It was really neat stuff. And explain to everybody, I mean, I know what it is, but explain to everybody what the Vocalese concept is all about.
Well, Vocalese is when you take an existing instrumental piece and you set lyrics to it and you sing it. So for us as a group, we would do it's kind of like what Lambert, Hendricks, and Ross were doing. That was a group that was like in the 50s and the 60s where they were taking Count Basie songs and they would sing it. With us, it was more expanded because we were doing, that was a collaboration we did with John Hendricks, who mm-hmm. was actually with Lambert Hendricks and Ross, and he was our mentor, you know. From all the way back in the beginning, we were doing John's music. We were singing Doodlin'. We did Four Brothers. That was on our third album. This was before we met John. I Want You to Be My Baby, a lot of different things that John had done. So when we met, and he also did Birdland. Mm-hmm. He did the lyrics for Birdland. So our friendship grew, and we talked about doing a project together. Now, prior to that, you know, we always had like maybe some jazz songs on our albums. Our albums were very eclectic. So we'd have rhythm and blues, we'd have some doo-wop, we'd have swing, we'd have, you know, and we'd have jazz. But with Vocalese, after having won the Grammy, on the coming out album, you know, prior to that, it wasn't on the coming out album. It was on the Mecca for Moderns album. After Birdland, we went for Boy from New York City and for Corner Pocket, which was a Count Basie song. And then we were thinking, you know, well, we've done that. So why don't we just do a pure jazz album? And we brought it to Amit. And Amit said, you got to be crazy. Are you crazy? You just had a hit, you know, with Boy from New York City. It was on the top 10. And you want to do a jazz album?
And it was crazy good, man.
It was, you know, but he said, okay, I'll tell you what. You go and do that. Get it out of off your chest, you know, go and do the album, and then we can get back to doing, you know, pop records and stuff like that. So that's what we did. And we had, you know, on the record, we had the Count Basie Orchestra. We had Bobby McFerrin, as you mentioned, you know, Dizzy Gillespie was on the album. I mean, we had, so many great jazz legends.
Did you have Louis Belson on that one?
No, Louis wasn't on it.
Okay.
No.
He was one of my drum teachers out in L.A. I just love Louis. I love Louis.
So that was it. So we did this album, and as it turned out, for the Grammys, we got 18 nominations. At the time, we got the most nominations next to Michael Jackson.
That's crazy.
Michael, I think, had gotten, you know, like maybe 19 or something, and we got 18. And out of those, we won three. And it was just, it was amazing. And it actually opened up this back door for us, because all of a sudden, we were being accepted as jazz singers. You know, prior to that, we were like pop singers. You know, when Coming Out came out, you know, our recording of Chanson d'Amour was number one in Europe for like a month, you know, number one in England and number one in France and all through Europe, you know, and it was like a pop song.
Well, you guys definitely kind of started the new category, jazz pop. You know, I mean, you all dominated it. And, you know, and I got to ask you at this point, was there a particular driving force that brought you the inspiration of being jazz pop? Is there a standout individual or somebody that you mentored?
Well, you know, I think it was just this. We never really followed anybody.
Okay.
You know, I think people are always looking to us in terms of what we were going to do next.
There you go. Yeah.
Because we kept changing. You know, we would go from one concept to another concept. You know, I think once we started working with Jay Graydon, and you know, in 1980, and we did two albums with Jay, and then we did Bodies and Souls with Dick Rudolph, I think at that point, especially because they were pop albums, and so we wanted to that at that point we that's why we said let's change. Let's do something else. It's kind of like David Bowie. He was exactly. Our inspiration.
He was like that.
Would create an image of himself, and then he'd destroy it.
Exactly. Yeah.
He'd create something else. So it was more about the artist, as opposed to doing one thing. And we really like that. That's what we don't want to be put into a box.
Yeah. Regarding all your biggest hits, Alan, you know, of course, we already know, we talked a little bit about Birdland already, but Boy from New York City, biggest hit record for you guys, right?
Yeah, I think it went to number 10. Twilight Zone went to number one in disco.
And you wrote that song, right?
Yeah, I wrote that with Jay Graydon. That was kind of like my insane, crazy idea.
Sound, a dimension of mind. You're moving through a land of both shadow and substance, of things and ideas. Guiding you through this wondrous journey is the hypnotic sound of the Twilight Zone.
I was always into the Twilight Zone, and as it turns out, he was into it as well. So it was kind of like, I said, I got this really weird, crazy idea. I said, why don't we write a song that's based on a Twilight Zone theme? And, you know, the theme had become something more than the television show. You know, it kind of became a social thing, you know, where if anything was kind of abnormal, supernatural or something, people would go, da na 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 da na na na, you know.
I still do that.
Right. So that's what we did. And it became a huge hit.
How about Operator? Where does that one line up, Operator?
Operator was on the first album.
Yeah.
And Operator came originally when Tim was at Villanova University. He went, they had a radio program there. So he was one of the jocks, you know, and stuff would always be coming in, you know, and he'd listen to it. So this one record came in by this group called the Friendly Brothers. Cleveland. All right. And it was Operator. Operator, Get Me Jesus on the Line.
Yeah.
It was so obscure and so strange because it was really kind of a rhythm and blues song.
Yeah.
So when we were putting together stuff for the first album, you know, he said, let's do Operator because it would be such a perfect song for Janis.
Operator, give me information, information, give me long distance, long distance.
Really wail on, you know, and so we recorded it, and that was our first single. And I remember when we started touring and we played down south, our audience was mostly black.
Oh, cool.
They didn't know we were white.
Yeah.
They felt we were a black group. So that was kind of a cool acknowledgement.
Joey D's got some of those reflections along that same line. You know, when they were playing, a lot of the stuff that they did sounded black. And, like Felix Cavalieri and those guys with the Rascals, they had some of those same similar stories, when I interviewed them. Okay, so here, the secret to vocal performance, Coca-Cola. Talk about that.
Well, everybody has a different something different that they do, for their voice, to keep it warm and stuff like that. Some people drink hot water, hot honey, which I do sometimes as well. But I found for myself that drinking Coca-Cola keeps my vocal cords moist.
Interesting,
So
man.
I always have a glass of Coca-Cola on stage.
Okay.
So
Well, hopefully you're
that's
not a
my thing.
diabetic. Hopefully you're not a diabetic because they got tons of sugar in that
And
Coke.
I never drink Coke. I mean, except for on stage when I'm working, I never drink Coke.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Interesting. Well, your falsetto, speaking of keeping your voice lubricated, your falsetto on Gloria blows me away, man. It is phenomenal.
Thank you.
Talk a little bit about that song, and of course, I'm going to play the version when you guys were doing a live show in Tokyo. But talk about Gloria a little bit.
Well, when I was in high school, Gloria as a vocal was kind of like Wipeout. If you were a drummer, you had to play wipe, but you had to play the fill, right?
Many times.
Right? Right?
Yeah.
And so Gloria was kind of like the same thing for falsetto singing. And when we were doing the first album, I brought the idea in to do Gloria.
Deal.
You know, Gloria has an interesting history, you know, because it was, you know, most people know it from the Cadillacs.
Right.
You know, they did the recording. But actually, there's a recording by the Mills Brothers doing Gloria.
I didn't know that.
Yes. And it's similar. You absolutely hear where their version came from. But I don't have it offhand. I don't know it offhand. But I remember on the album, when it came down to writing the credits for who wrote Gloria, I wrote down the original writers of Gloria because the manager of the Cadillacs, she took the credit for writing Gloria. And I
Oh,
went,
wow.
no, you didn't write Gloria. You know, you adapted Gloria. But and so it just happened, you know. I didn't discover my falsetto until I was in Greece,
Yeah.
actually. Because when I was in college, you know, I actually studied classically. And my voice is a bass baritone, naturally. So that's what I did. So I never really went there. I never went up in the range. But when I was in Greece, you know, singing Beauty School Dropout, you know, I had to go up into that thing. And I just kind of opened up my mouth and discovered this other part of my voice.
How big is your range, Alan?
My range is about, four octaves and a fourth, a
Wow.
three octaves and a fourth. One, two, three, and a fourth. Yeah.
And when you were singing with Tim, how much you were doing all the highs, I guess, right?
Well, now actually, when we started, I was actually singing bass,
Oh my gosh.
and Tim was singing tenor because, you know, when he was in high school, you know, he had a group called the Criterions and he sang second tenor. So when we got together, I said, well, you know, when I was in school, I was singing bass and you know, and so that's how we started out. So like on Candy, on the early stuff, that's me on the bottom and Tim is singing the higher part. But my range is wider than Tim's. So it got to a point where we said, you know what, we should switch. So I think it was like kind of maybe four or five songs that we did, and then we switched.
And you've maintained that position ever since, right? You're pretty much doing all the tenor parts.
I sing tenor,
Yeah.
you know, which I think for me is probably the hardest of everybody in the group because I'm singing out of my range. You
And
know,
you got to be spot on, man.
Janis is an alto,
Yeah.
Cheryl is a soprano, and they're kind of singing where they're supposed to. Tim was singing bass. Trist Curless, who's now, you know, in the group, he's bass. But I'm a baritone singing tenor. And, you know, I think the hardest part for me was always the middle.
Yeah.
And I would study, you know, we would all study voice, you know, just to keep the chops up and everything else. And that was always what I worked on. It
Yeah.
was always the middle voice.
What's amazing to me, and I mentioned this to you last time we talked, is how you've been able to, maintain your chops, and you sound as good now as you ever have, so that's just blows me away, because a lot of the entertainers that I've interviewed and stuff, I mean, they're all still very good, but they've had to lower the keys a little bit because the voices sometimes just can't handle it as we get older. But in your case, I think because you guys have stayed so active in singing so much all the time is probably contributing to that fact.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. Doing that because, you know, the vocal cords are, you know, it's muscles.
Yeah.
It's going to the gym and working out. So you have to stay on top of it, you know.
Yeah. Use it or lose it.
Use it or
Okay.
lose it.
We have talked about a lot of stuff, but I think I'd be making a big mistake if I didn't ask you to talk a little bit about analog versus digital. You know, we have both been in the business a long time to see major changes in the industry, especially in the studio. And I always used to say, there's something about walking into a studio and the smell of Mylar. Nothing like it. But talk a little bit about analog and digital and how that impacted you guys in the industry. You know, I'm sure you've got some interesting stories about that.
Well, I mean, we started out as an analog group.
Yep.
You know, so we would sing around one mic, you know, a Neumann 67.
Know it well.
Tube mic was our go-to mic, you know, and, you know, there was something about tape,
mm-hmm.
the warmth of tape. It just has a quality that digital does not have. Certainly digital has come a long way. You know, I think with as broadband increased, you know, the sampling rates, you know, have gotten much, much better. And there are ways that you can simulate that. But, you know, working in analog, you know, I got to tell you, you know, I miss slicing the tape and sticking it on the wall.
God, I can't
people
tell
don't
you
realize
from the old know? From the old days of especially when you would break a tape and you'd have to get that splicer out, you know, and lay the tape down and splice it back together. I mean, it's just nothing like it.
Yeah. But on the other hand, I love digital.
Oh yeah,
I love editing, you know, with digital. It's just so fantastic, you know, everything that you can do, you know, with, you know, working on whatever program, whether it's Pro Tools or Logic or Cubase, you know, being able to do that and the amount of tracks that you can record onto and not lose anything. You know, the problem with analog was that you'd get a master, you know. Mm-hmm. So let's say for those people that don't understand, so you get the band to come in and they're going to, and they record, they put everything down. But then we would have to do our vocal. So instead of playing the tape that the master tape that they recorded on over and over again, each time you would play tape, you would lose definition. The sound would deteriorate a little bit. So you would take the 24 track or 48 tracks, if you connected, you know, the tape recorders together, and then you would bring it down to a stereo mix. So that then when we did our vocals, you know, we would be able to not lose anything from the instrumental. And it was the same thing with the vocals. I mean, we would try, you know, not to do, hopefully we would get it right. You know, it's different with digital. I don't know too many people that actually record around one mic anymore. It's usually for groups, you know, it's usually individual mics because it's easier to control.
Yeah, you know? I think you're right. I think the last time we recorded out in L.A., well, that wasn't the last time I recorded, but I mean, when we were out there doing that that session, we did stand around one mic because we were all basically singing like a live performance. We had our headphones on, so, and you guys do that, I mean, even to today, but that's what we were doing then, but it was around one mic because we could all hear each other and be all right there, you know, in front of that Neumann.
Yeah.
But
and you get your balance by moving in or out.
Exactly.
So you do 12 bars and then you listen and you say, okay, you move back, you come in, you know,
yeah.
until you got it right, you know.
So well, let's talk about 2022. You guys did your last album. It's called 50. And How long did you guys take to produce that album, and how did you decide what cuts you were going to put on there for this very special anniversary album?
Yeah, well, it was challenging to figure out what material we were going to, what songs we were going to do. This was a collaboration with the Funk House Orchestra, the WDR Funk House Orchestra out of Cologne. And we had done a concert with them in 2021, or maybe it was 2020. No, no, 2019 is when we did it. And we had, it was such a wonderful experience working together that we said, you know, we should do a project. And so we decided that we would do something. And then the pandemic hit, COVID.
Mm-hmm.
But getting back to finding material. So because we were doing it with a symphony, the considerations were songs that were popular, but also songs that perhaps we felt never really got recognition, or that would really work well with a symphony. So that was the criteria for picking songs. So I think we started with like 50, and then we went down to 10 songs. And we got different orchestrators to different songs to do that, but the whole process was really, really challenging because of the pandemic. So in 2021, I think we kind of started doing stuff, and we had to do everything separate. So we had our band, who are mostly in New York, put down a rhythm track, mm-hmm. the rhythm section. And also they had to change the key, because maybe some people don't realize this, but whenever you hear an orchestra tune up or a band tune up, that you a lot of times they'll tune up to the piano. Well, here in the States, an A is 440.
Okay.
But in Europe, it's 442.
Wow.
So they had to change the tuning on the piano here in order for it to be in tune with the orchestra, which means for us, everything was a little bit higher, but not that much. You wouldn't really notice. It's about 7 degrees or something like that. But so they would do that. They put down the rhythm, tracks. And then, first of all, you would have the orchestration. So they'd actually have to wait for the orchestration to be done. Then they would record the rhythm tracks separately. And then that was sent to the orchestra, and they had to record separately.
It's an incredible orchestra. You know, out of everything I've heard you guys do, and I mean, you've done it with Basie, you've done it with Belson, you've done it with so many big bands, Gillespie, so many greats. Why this group? I mean, this group, this symphony is primo, man. I'm such beautiful music.
Yeah, I mean, they're incredible musicians. Again, it was because we had performed with them, and we just decided that we would do a project together.
Well, you know, and that brings up a thought that I have here that I was thinking about earlier today that I was going to try to work into this, and I'm glad I just thought of it again. Out of all of the different combinations that you played with, whether it be a small ensemble, a small big band, or a symphonic orchestra, when you all were either going on tours or even doing one-nighters, would it be your song list, your book, that would determine whether you were going to use a symphony versus a smaller ensemble? Or who would decide whether you're going to have a big band sound or an orchestra or symphony or whatever in that process?
Booking.
Booking? Okay.
Booking. So, dates would come up, let's say for a symphony date. A lot of times when we would do our Christmas album, when we would do our Christmas show, we would have a small symphony. We'd have a small string section, maybe twelve, four to 12 violins, six viola, four cello, something like that, and then we'd have a big band included with that, so that we could do the entire show. So we would do that sometimes. But most of the time we would just, we would tour with our band, which was either a trio or a quartet. Depends on when, sometime when we did our Brazil album, we had a percussionist alongside our drummer, and it all depends.
One of the songs that I absolutely love on that 50 album is the one Agua. And of course, I asked you the other day why Agua instead of Awa, and you were telling me because of the Brazilian nature of that, right?
Yeah,
Yeah.
that's yeah, it's how it's pronounced, Agua. So yeah, the song was written by Jovan, and we had done it originally on our Brazil album, and that was one of the songs that we thought would just be so beautiful with an orchestra. Got Vince Mendoza, who's a wonderful orchestrator, to do that, to write that chart for us.
It's absolutely gorgeous. Just a beautiful song. On December 15th, 2023, you guys performed your very last show at the Walt Disney Concert Hall there in LA. Talk about the feeling that night. It had to have been bittersweet for you guys.
It was bittersweet, and still is bittersweet in a way. But it was something, we've been touring for so long, and it's gotten harder, much harder, for various reasons. You know, touring is touring. It works the same way. You know, you have a tour that's put together, and it's a lot of travel. A lot of travel, either on flying or on buses. You know, because we're an international group. You know, when we play in Europe, for example, I mean, we're hopping from one country to another. You know, and sometimes, you know, it's like 12 hours on a bus, and then you got to go and do a gig, you know, or, you know, it's flying, and the state of the way the world is right now, flights are being canceled, and it's just wear and tear on our bodies. So we made a decision that we weren't going to tour anymore.
It's a hard life, man. It's a hard life.
We're still together, and, you know, we'll do special things, you know, that come up, you know, but we all felt, I think, that it was time to do that.
Are you all living in L.A., Alan?
No, I live in L.A. My partner, Trist, lives in Glendale, which is kind of near Pasadena, around there.
In the valley.
Cheryl lives in Palm Springs, and Janis is the diehard New Yorker.
Oh, wow. Okay.
She lives in the city.
So it's not like you can say, okay, guys, next weekend we're going to have a rehearsal. You know, it's not going to be that easy.
Yeah. No. We have to really schedule it out, you know, at a place where, you know, if we're going back east, then, you know, we'll schedule time, you know, to rehearse there. Or if, you know, we're going to do something out here, then, you know, we'll rehearse. You know, sometimes it's, you know, while we're on the road, you know, where we'll take a couple of days or something to work on something. But it's challenging. Very challenging that way. It was so much easier when we were all together and we can get together and rehearse.
Yeah. Well, Alan, it's getting close to the end of this of today's journey with you. You have any closing statements or thoughts or anything you'd like to share?
What can I say? It's been a remarkable journey. Something that I never thought, I don't think any of us ever thought that you know, we would go this long, this far, you know. So grateful to all of our fans around the world, you know, that have stuck by us, you know, through everything, you know, all the changes, and just, man, just so grateful.
Thank you, Alan, for coming on with me today, man. It's absolutely a treat to have one of the biggest, most wonderful entertainers in the industry, man. God has blessed you with a beautiful gift, and you have blessed us with that gift for the last 50 years. You are truly one of the best, my friend, and I want to thank you once again for being what you are, who you are, and we'll see you again sometime.
All right.
I'm going to close this show today with another one of my favorites, and it's called God Only Knows. Thank you, Alan.
You're welcome, Rick.
See you soon, my friend.
All right.
Bye-bye.
You'll never need to doubt it. God only knows what I'd be without.